My pleasure is to now to introduce the next speaker, Frank Weichold.
Yeah.
And you can continue with describing what the U.S. Is doing.
Yeah, sure. So thank you very much. I think the first time India is joining, representing these regulatory bodies, and really we are thankful for that. To Biet and Anil for their encouragement. Now, if you look in India, there are these four main the government agencies. They work together, particularly in the nano and emerging fields, in particularly biomedical research. Now, the central body is the Department of Science and Technology, who has created the Nanomedicine in 2007. There are 25 centers of excellences in nano research in India, which is ranging from the advanced biosensor and the nano electronics, nanomaterial science, most of these Indian Institute of Technology and Indian Institute of Science. Apart from that, there are several biomedical applications. If you see our the number of publication, if in world, if you statistics, the number one is China, number two is US, and number three is India. But when we come down to actual application development, we are really not doing well. So we realize this major problem is the regulatory hurdle which we are facing over the past several years. Now the regulatory body is the CDSCO, that is the Central Drug Standard Regulatory Authority, and which works under Drug Controller General of India. And so we realize so they are the regulatory bodies, and the clinical trial regulators are the Department of Health Research, earlier which used to call the Indian Council of Medical Research. Now, though we have got very strict the rules and regulation for all these preclinical trial and clinical trial, and as you know, in the pharmaceutical industry, India has got a very strong infrastructure and strong market share. We have got large number of GMP facility, GLP facility, which is there in India working for the pharmaceutical industry. But so far as nano is concerned, obviously, we have a gap. And so in my next three or four slides I have made, I'll just try to tell you, give you a glimpse of the Indian pharmaceutical industry. It's really, really growing very fast. And in fact, its growth is quite exponential. And if you see their strategy, the apart from generic, now they are looking for actually introducing the newer emerging fields, so nanomedicine, as well as the lot of biosimilars and biologics. And if you see the lowermost, the current the situation, just today there are very few nanoformulations in the market in India, which is developed by Indian companies. But if you see, there are quite a few, more than 20 of these formulations which are in the pipeline stage. I think around 5 are in the clinical trial. And obviously, I mentioned the Doxil, the Lipodox, these are in the market. So it is projected that in the next 10 to 15 years, there will be almost 57% of the growth in the particularly the nanoformulation development in India. Now, last year, I think, we developed these guidelines for evaluation of nanopharmaceutical in India. So nanopharmaceutical is same as nanomedicine, but somehow the DCGI, Professor G.N. Singh and Pradhan, they were part, and myself and Professor Y.K. Gupta, who are mainly do the regulatory research, so all come together and edited that. And obviously we are now it's open, discussion is going on in modification of this guideline. And in fact, we have requested US FDA, who will be coming in October. And there obviously we will be training our regulators, and also we will have an open discussion about that, how we have developed the guideline and how to enforce that. And that will, I'm sure, quite help us to really, really bridge the gap. Now, the perspective when we edited that whole guideline, the couple of things we have made it very clear. See, nanotechnology is a really, really enabling technology. You can apply it anywhere. And it's basically can help you to develop complex technologies like the theranostics, where you can do the imaging and the therapy together. I think anything you can do. So if you see the innovation component, there are very strong innovations which are coming up from almost 25 centers of excellences. But we are very cautious about that. We know the innovation promoting, there are a lot of money government is pushing in to the research area. There are quite a few collaborative research with US and Europe is going on. And obviously, we know that it can lead to economic growth and social development. We look for particularly the nanotechnology application for a low-cost, high-efficiency system development, which will be very useful for developing countries. Now, on this side, we have got a very concerned about protection of the public health, safety and environmental ecosystem, and international harmonization. I think we, in that guideline, we are trying to get a flexible approach, and that's why I feel the title of the discussion point, the smart, the asset system development is very important to really, really help this innovation to prove their safety is higher than their risk. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Professor Dinda, for giving an overview about the system in India and also the perspective for your country. Now, I'm afraid we've actually missed still Frank Weichold's intervention.
If I may, Director General.
I'm sorry, Lada.
That's okay. Yeah.
No, Director General, we actually made a decision about this because two people from FDA is an unequal balance. So Katrin and I, we combined our comments because we certainly work for the same organization. We pull in the same direction.
Okay,
but,
fine.
But if there are specific questions for me from the audience, I will take them later.
Okay. So the point is clear now. Please, Lada. Sorry.
No worries.
Sorry for that. Now you can give us the Swiss perspective.
Please. Yes.